May the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and redeemer.
Amen.
This past week, I attended an educational conference entitled Ready by Five. That's the title of the book. Without going into the nuts and bolts of all that I, as Judy Freeman, learned this past week, one aspect of that learning had to do with data collection. Data is important to all organizations which want to move forward and to grow as an organization. Data is factual and must by necessity be truthful. A powerful TV commercial these days has to do with a particular channel that says there's an apple. And an apple is not a banana. And a banana is not an apple. Seek facts first. Data, the collection of facts, is to be collected, studied, and held to standards of scrutiny for accuracy and relevance. We keep copious records at St. Mark's, some of which date all the way back to 1836. Data for early childhood education is extremely important. Children have needs and are impressionable. What we do in terms of loving and caring for them, as well as helping them to learn to read and to grow, is extremely important. I have every confidence that our church school program accomplishes all of those things, helping our little ones learn more about themselves and their relationship with God. The purposeful collection of data is the first step in any short or long-range study. Our own strategic plan ministry continues to gather data updated and revised from various ministries for purposes of good planning for the future. Pulling collected data apart is called disaggregation, thus separating out of specific information for further study and planning purposes. To use that information is to learn more than what might appear on the surface. Now, as somewhat complex as that might sound, we can use a similar process to glean more information from the study of the Ethiopian eunuch in today's first reading. I believe it's a fascinating story, so well read by John. To get to a deeper level of what the story might mean, we might ask questions. Do you remember the game 20 questions? I had to do a little research to collect data about that game. So here's what I found. 20 questions is a spoken parlor game which encourages deductive reasoning and creativity. In a traditional game, one player is chosen to be the answerer. That person chooses the subject but does not reveal it to others. The other players are questioners. They each take turns asking a question which can be answered with a simple yes or no. Parents among us must know this game very well. By asking questions, we can get to a deeper appreciation and understanding for what the story about the Ethiopian eunuch and Philip might mean to us. They encountered one another miraculously on the Ethiopian eunuch's journey. journey back home to Ethiopia. Our first question might be, who was Philip? Because it is his name that we hear first in the story. The answer to that question is that Philip was one of the seven original deacons in the early church. He was also an evangelist, a herald of the gospel in various parts of that area. And how do we know that? Chapter 8 in the book of Acts tells us. The next question might be, who or what is a eunuch? A eunuch is a man who has been castrated for the purpose of trusted servitude in a royal household. In the Hebrew scriptures, we can read about eunuchs in the book of Esther, as well as in the book of Daniel. And in the Christian scriptures, in the book of Acts, the unnamed eunuch was from Ethiopia. We can reason that he was a Jew, because he was returning to Ethiopia having worshipped in the temple in Jerusalem. The story tells us that the eunuch was on his way home and was reading from a scroll of Isaiah. How he got that scroll might be another question. On the eunuch's trip home, the story tells us that he encountered Philip. In that encounter, he found a disciple of Jesus who opened his mind and heart to the knowledge of God in Jesus. We learn that both the eunuch and Philip found themselves in the same place on the road from Jerusalem to Gaza. A providential meeting, no doubt, for the eunuch. In the scroll from Isaiah, the eunuch had just read the text, like a shepherd who was led to the slaughter, and like a man, a lamb, silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. A clear reference for us as Christians to Jesus. Having read that text, the eunuch asked Philip an important question, a question that was perhaps not just important to the eunuch, but is important to us as well in our lives of faith. About whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? For us as Christians, the answer to that question is Jesus, the Good Shepherd, the one who gave his life that we might have life. A question we might consider about the story is, how was the encounter a life-changing event for the eunuch? And how is that encounter a life-changing event for us as well? The eunuch was led to faith in Jesus and to his baptism at the hands of Philip. And you'll know this miraculous body of water just appears, right? Filled with the Spirit of the risen Christ, Philip enabled the eunuch to experience and embrace the Spirit of Jesus. As a community of faith in this place, our lives are impacted by the faith we claim and by the one whom we strive to follow. What does it mean to follow Jesus, the risen Christ? What does it mean to be transformed by this encounter? And are we convinced that Jesus abides in us and that we abide in him? Today's gospel tells us that those who abide in Jesus will bear much fruit. So, what does that mean? 20 questions? Perhaps even more. My friends, prayer is often about questions. Look at how questions impact the Ethiopian eunuch. filled. Filled with the Spirit of the risen Christ, we can be confident that our questions will not go unheard. We can be confident that no matter what happens to us in life, Jesus abides with us. We can be confident that the fruit of that relationship is love. A love which teaches us and enables us to love others. We are the beloved community.